Oh, well, I guess you guys want to know where we are. Well, we are Arlington. We were fighting last night over a stupid picture of where it was at, right? Now, I do know that a certain individual was in town. Oh, would you like to introduce us and tell us who we are?
Welcome to the X-Fan Show Afternoon Delight.
Why can't I hear you?
You can't hear me?
Why are you very quiet?
Am I quiet?
I cannot hear you. You were very, very quiet, bro.
Really?
I love it.
How about
love
it.
Don't hear you.
How about now? How about?
Okay, there you go. Now I can hear you better. Okay.
All right.
Yeah, so, Arlington, would you like to introduce everybody and tell us who we are?
Sure. Welcome to the X-Fan Show, ladies and gentlemen. This is the Afternoon Delight special. As always, I am the A-Train Arlington Lane, and that coffee-grinded cough meister
with my hot water.
Hot water is my partner in crime, Dirty. Good afternoon to those all over the world, the country, and whatnot.
Right now, Arlington, back to what we were saying before I decided to really screw everything up. We got a big show tonight. We have...
At least that's what I've been told.
One of our favorite players, Kenneth Farrow. One of the biggest selling jerseys of 2020. A man who is building up his... player union for all spring football people. Will be joining us at 11:15. Just about, I guess, what is that?
10 minutes. About 10 minutes.
Right. Yeah. President of the United Football Players Association. We're going to talk to him about, you know, the Player Academy and what it's all taken to build the union and all that good stuff. But let's get to it, Arlington. Did St. Louis mess up again?
Did St. Louis mess up again? How would you say St. Louis messed up in this case, sir?
So, like I said, I do know that I was in town earlier this week, right? Then a young man on Twitter put a picture out at a camp with Ricky Prohl. And Ricky Prohl had something in his hand. You have that picture?
Find it, man. And I can't find it anymore.
Oh. Did they take it down?
I hope they didn't, man.
Let's see. I'm going to go check here and see if I can find it real quick. Oh, nope. I got it, Arlington. Hold on. Let me do this.
You're going to be able to put the picture up?
I am. I'm going to do it something different, though, because I had to update my I had to update one of our machines. So I'm down one machine. But
down one machine.
I am. But watch this, Arlington. You ready? Let me get to it. No, I'm not going to be able to. I can do it this way.
You got a different way that you can do it?
I do. I thought you needed the picture, but you can't find it anywhere?
You can't find it anywhere, man. The only way I can do this... Hold on.
Yeah, we're not doing it that way. What you're talking about. We ain't doing it that way, dude.
I'm going to have to do it this way.
Well, because here's the reason why. So I tried to replicate this picture, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And guess what? It did not work out very well. And Arlington, if you don't remember, I had said a few months ago. That I have seen.
Go ahead.
I've seen the uniforms. You got the echo. You got to turn one of them down, bro. The great colleague joined us. You got to turn that down. But,
go ahead.
Oh, I know how you were going to do it through your phone, right? I had said, I have seen the uniforms, folks. And I had. And what? The logo has changed. Whether you want to believe it or not. Look, I have the logo right here on my hat. Right there. There's the logo on my hat. You see it? There's the logo right there on my hat. Look at it, Arlington. You see the logo, Arlington?
I see it.
The logo. You're right there on my hat, right? Now look at the wings. Look at the wings. Look how they're a little rounded, right? Correct?
Yep.
Rounded. Guess what? New one. They're not so rounded anymore. They're not. Are they?
So you say.
They're not rounded. The uniform changed. The uniform is more pointed. The uniform, the logo is changed. It's more cleaner lines. All of that good stuff, right?
Right.
I hate to tell you, but our logo has changed. Not much. Not much, just slightly. Just slightly our uniform has changed, people. So don't get all upset, okay? Get all upset and want to kill somebody or get all huffy paw. But it has changed just a little. Oh, there he is. There is the great colleague. See, there it is. I hear it again, though. So, Arlington, as we were fighting over stupid pictures of palm trees and where they were at and all that good stuff, right? We completely missed that. And now everybody else has got it all up there. Here's the logo. It was out there. The logo is there. So the Battlehawk logo did not change. Slightly changed with some modification. I mean, Arlington, what do you think of it? You saw it. You zoomed in. I'm still looking for it. So.
Yeah, I mean, don't worry about it. Don't worry about that.
Why did I have a cowboy jersey?
Oh, I lost a bet.
Huh?
I lost a bet. I lost a bet. That's what happened. I'm sorry. You know I'm not a fan of this team anyway, right? You already know that. But, folks, this is the picture that Dirty has been talking about. You see it right there in front of you, right? And then
there it
what
is.
What we were arguing about, right, was that thing in the corner. We argued about what was behind it. But there's something at the bottom left. Excuse me, bottom right, in Ricky Pro's hand.
Uh-huh.
And it looked like a battle hawk, right?
Well, that don't look like a battle hawk. That's a battle hawk logo.
The logo, right?
That's straight up the logo. Now, if you notice, on the bottom, look, I'm going to turn my hand around again, Arlington, right? So if you notice, oh, we can't scoot the pick. Oh, there we go. Okay, I can do this. There we go. I was just going to scoot over a little bit. Look, you notice this part where the sword is filled in of Ricky Pearl. Where in 2020, it's filled in, right? Okay. You notice on the wings are more, not say pointed, just more kind of rounded, looking like the new Arizona Cardinal logo. The lines are a lot thinner, a lot crisper. I just went thinner. I just rolled my R on thinner, and there's no R in fucking thinner. Excuse my language.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, yeah, it's the ER.
There's an
right.
R.
Yeah.
What are you talking about?
What? So did Ricky Pearl mess up? Did he mess up, Arlington?
I don't think he did. I don't think so.
You think that was going on purpose?
I think that was just so happened that it was a piece of paper that had the old Battlehawk logo, because I still think that's what it is, the old 2020 logo on
there.
What
if I tell you it's not?
I wouldn't believe you.
What if I tell you that I've seen that logo on a prototype?
And that's the new one, is what you're telling me?
Yep.
I wouldn't believe
cleaner,
you.
Cleaner, crisper, all that stuff.
All right, let's take a look.
No, you have an old logo?
No.
I pulled the old logo.
No, I'm about to pull up that.
Yeah. Look at it. It's crisper, cleaner. You see it?
Yeah.
Cleaner, crisper, all that stuff than the old logo.
It does look a little bit different.
It is, you know, like I said.
You're trying to figure out the color scheme and stuff. So, folks, if you have YouTube and you're watching it on television, which I'm grateful if you are, you can go to the front of your screen and try to do a deep dive and see what that looks like. I don't think it's a big thing.
Do you really? Really? Like, anchored in greatness isn't a great thing? Or
football? No. I ain't talking about the taglines and stuff. I'm not talking about the taglines, my friend.
Right? Yeah.
I'm only worried about what is actually out there.
Well, look, here's what I'm telling you. I've seen prototypes of the uniforms, of the Battle Hawks uniform. That's that logo. Oh, Arlington, look who it is. Oh, wait, he just
left. Well, we're going to get to that in just a second.
Right.
We got to ask for the time. Hey, and guess what? The time is now, right? Ladies and gentlemen, the time is now. Former running back of the Seattle Dragons and he's president of the United Football Players Association. Grateful to have him on this show today. The one and only Mr. Kenneth Farrow. Kenneth, good afternoon to you, sir. How you doing, man? Oh, we got to see if we can get him unmuted.
Hear me?
There you go.
There we go.
There we go. We're locked in. How's it going, y'all?
Good. How you doing today, man? Hey, I've been trying to get you to come on this show for quite some time now. And
man,
grateful to have you on and whatnot. And one thing that I do want to touch on a bit is, come on, we're going to take it back.
Arlington, before you go any further, look at the man. Look at the lines he's got going. He's looking good. Look at that. Look at that, Arlington. He is styling and profiling. Look
hey,
at
and
that.
I see the U of H. I see the U of H
hey,
there.
Hey, we're fresh out the barbershop and headed to the gym, man. So you got me. We've been moving.
Look at him all lined up looking.
Yeah, he looking good, right, man. You know he's an H channel just like I am, Dirty.
I know that. I know he is.
That's right. See, I know. There? But I got to touch a bit about it, man. We'll get into the Players Association and stuff in a little bit, but I want to touch on, you know, your past time with the Seattle Dragons and whatnot, man. What was that experience like for you when you were able to go out there? You got to play in San Antonio, and I know my people in San Antonio are going to be excited a bit to see you out there, even though whoever team, they hoping that you play for San Antonio. But tell us a bit about your experience in Seattle, you know, with the Seattle Dragons.
Seattle was cool, man. You know, it was a very a similar environment as far as football goes. I think it was, you know, obviously you got the Seahawks there. The city definitely came out and showed lots of love. So, yeah, I definitely enjoyed my time out there. But, you know, it's hard to sit here and say with three Texas teams that, you know, I want to be anywhere else when it comes down to it. So, you know.
Yeah, no doubt about it. Okay, so check this out. You got a chance to play in Seattle. You play in front of a big crowd. But you also got the chance to come to St. Louis, and you saw how big their crowd was. Now, I understand you know, big Seattle. You got to be Seattle all day when you were playing with them. But that's done. This is 2-3 years later now.
Right.
You got to ask, hey, the question is this. What crowd did you like better? The Seattle crowd or did you like the St. Louis crowd or how loud they were? I'm not
The St. Louis, the whole environment, man, the dome, the way they packed the stadium, that was very similar to San Antonio, I feel like, with the Alamo Dome. And I think anytime you can get a football like that in a place like that, I think that's kind of, you know, that's as good as it gets when you can pack a dome like that and have it rocking how St. Louis had it rocking. So they were definitely up there.
That's what's up. Go, hey, I'll tell you right now, I saw you out there in action, and I think it was you and BJ Daniels, you know, guys used to play for the Seahawks and whatnot, and you got a chance to get some NFL action yourself, and I think in Miami. And, lately, what has it been for you getting yourself prepared for this upcoming draft that's coming up in November? What have you been doing lately?
Man, it's just, you know, at this point in my career, I've played for, you know, I was with the Chargers, the Dolphins, the Patriots. You know, I played in the AAF, I played in the XFL. And I think, you know, I feel like every time I've been able to get on the field, I've been able to be impactful. And it's just a part of being a professional. You know, you start to learn how your body, you learn where your body needs to be, when it needs to be. And so it's been no different, man. You go through the year, you do your training, you have your, you know, you have your down times, you have your up times. And then I think with COVID, that kind of really threw a lot of guys off, and they kind of had time to kind of sit back and kind of reevaluate, you know, what they wanted to do. And, you know, I looked at the USFL, we looked at the XFL, and, you know, my whole thing was when I saw that The Rock was buying it, I felt like it was going to be done in such a way that he's proven that they're going to do it. You know, right now, I think there's a lot of people in place. I think there's a lot of things in place that are very high level with high level people that have been playing the game for a long time. So you kind of expect a top level of professionalism to come with this new XFL. And I think at the end of the day, the guys that can go out there and execute at a high level, they want to be in environments like that. They want to be in leagues like that. So at the end of the day, man, it's going to be an opportunity to get out on the field. And the cool thing about football is, you know, there's film, there's tape, and you're only going to be able to do what you can put on tape. And so I think for the guys that get that, the guys that are professionals and take their craft seriously, they're always going to be ready when that film comes on. And so, you know, that's what we do. We've been training. We've been getting right. We've been getting ready. And when it's time, you know, it's time to go.
Now, Kenneth, you say that everything, which, I mean, when you were in Seattle, I mean, you were possibly one of the more prolific runners that the league had, you know, United Football Players Union, right? Now that the XFL struck that partnership up with the Academy, right? Oh, the NFL Academy and getting that tape out there and all that. Now, how important is that partnership with that NFL Academy for guys wanting to take that next step?
You know, that's huge, and I think it just shows, you know, it shows the legitimacy, it shows the time and the effort and the energy that they've spent on figuring out how can we make this thing most beneficial for players. And I think you look at those partnerships, you look at the people that they brought in for head coaches. We're not talking about, you know, we're talking about Hall of Famers that they brought in as head coaches. And so I think guys look at these situations, and there's a ton of respect from everybody right now with what they have going on. And I think the partnership with the NFL Academy is huge as well. It's like, okay, there's a league that has started up, but what are their ties? What are their relationships with to be able to get guys to that next level? Is there communication going on? Is there access? And I think with some of the things that they've shown to put in place right now, I think it's a true league that is really going to give players direct access and be able to provide, you know, lots of opportunities for scouts, for NFL coaches and things like that, to be able to take a real look at guys from an everyday practice standpoint and, you know, whatever the case may be. So I know guys are definitely excited about all the things that the XFL has put in place.
So with that being said, so where does that leave you? Because, I mean, I know that you've been literally working your tail off for this United Football Players Association. So, like, where does that leave you at? Where are you taking your direction with that in regards of, or even if you could talk about it or even comment it, like working with the XFL, working with the USFL, like, where does that leave you at with your association that you've been working with? If you could talk about it.
Yeah, you know, I mean, our biggest thing was once COVID had shut down the XFL, there was a couple leagues that it came up. There was combine events. There was a lot of things going on that were just kind of taking advantage of players and kind of the desperation to want to be able to have a real opportunity. There was fraudulent things going on. There was guys flying out to cities, and the things that were said and promoted weren't going on. There was even, you know, problems with guys getting paid and things like that in some of these other leagues. And so when we looked at, you know, the USFL and things that you know, they had in place in the beginning. We felt like, based off our experiences going through the AAF, going through the XFL, there was things that we as players could have a voice in to make things a little bit smoother, just in terms of what we need as players to feel like we're in a professional environment to be able to provide us the tools that we need to be able to, one, get through a season healthy, and two, be able to just, you know, execute the job and do the job that we needed to do. And so I think that was important for us to get that up in the USFL, because we felt like, you know, that kind of came out of nowhere, and it was fast, and it did happen fast. Those guys showed up, and 23 days later, they were having to play a game. And so we were, you know, happy to get down there and try to set up as much help as we possibly could. And we accomplished, you know, our goal of being able to get that unionized and get those guys to play to the table and be able to talk about, you know, things that we want to see, you know, better, or things that we want to improve on for year two. And so, you know, as we stepped back and we got that done, we got a guy that's been a part of two CBAs in the Arena League, been an Arena League player for about 10, 11 years, has worked with Gene Upshaw and, you know, done a lot of things from a Players Association standpoint with Ryan Cave. And he's kind of taken the handle on that as those guys have dug into negotiations and things like that. And so now, you know, we're looking at the XFL, and it's like I said, we've really kind of seen the things that they put in place, and everybody is really confident about going to camp, going to be able to start this XFL season and have just basic needs and necessities met because of the things that they've kind of rolled out and shown that they already have ready and up and running, and the different departments that they have. So, you know, I think for me, it's been, it has been a lot of work, but a lot of the work is already set in stone. And it was kind of, you know, our goal from the beginning. We wanted to get something in place that allowed us to have a voice in situations where we felt like were unfair or not up to standards or not being done in a professional way. I think we got that done. I think that's up and rolling. And now with the XFL coming up, you look at the people in place, and I don't think anybody expects this thing to be done unprofessionally. So now it's just kind of, you know, now we're excited to get back to playing and try to, you know, squeeze out a couple more years, you know, while we still can. So that's kind of where our focus is now. And luckily we have a lot of good guys that we brought on that know what they're doing, that are more versed and more experienced in CBAs, in players associations, than myself, kind of taking the charge on those things.
A lot of good information right there.
As being a union guy myself, you know, being in unions and stuff, to see how quick we got this union set up, to me, was amazing. I mean, you were on top of it and all of that. Have you heard from the XFL? And you've already said that you got season two going with the USFL, but have you heard from the XFL saying, hey, you know, we are willing to sit down at a table? Or even if you could talk about it, we are willing to sit down with you at a table to kind of see where we can have a fair compromise between your guys' union and are can you talk about it?
We haven't really got there. I think, like I said, the whole point of us coming together and doing what we're doing was because there was a real lack of basic necessities that were needed for guys to get through a season in terms of medical, in terms of injuries and things like that. And so it's kind of been a deal where, you know, we were able to assess pretty quickly what was going to be laid out for the guys going into the USFL, and saw that they needed a lot of help. And we just don't have that feeling about the XFL. So if we get to that point and that conversation comes up, we'll get there. But for the most part, I think guys are pretty confident in what the XFL has put together. Is that saying that there's not going to be a conversation later on down the road? You know, we don't know that yet, but right now it's like, from standing back from afar, it looks like everything's being put in place and being done in a way where it's like, there is no immediate need for any type of, you know, interjection of us trying to get things done. So that's kind of our standpoint on it right now. We haven't heard too much from them at all. So, that's kind of where we're at right now.
Amazing. We're talking with Kenneth Farrow, right now on the X Fan Show. And he's former running back of the Seattle Dragons. And currently, as you can hear, he has spoken a bit about what's been going on at the United Football Players Association. And you speak highly of that. So what we just heard from you, you're not getting any like potential like blowback on what's been going on with the XFL. I know on the front end, it looks like nothing is going on. But from the back end, what you're telling me is that things are lining up in a way of sorts for what you got going on with the players that are going to potentially participate in the XFL, correct?
What do you mean? I got lost there a little bit.
Kind of like when you're saying, because, you know, on the front side, you know, us fans are trying to figure out what's going on. But on the back end, you know, with the players themselves, which is what is the main thing that make the league work, you guys are getting things worked out with the league and there are no, like, big drawbacks or anything that's, you know, keeping you guys from getting taken care of is what I mean.
Right. As far as speaking from a players association part for the players union from the USFL, I think things have gone very well. We were able to get that up off the ground and relations have been very cooperative. And like I said, at the end of the day, it wasn't our goal to come in and try to take over or get more money. It was just, we saw things that could be fixed that weren't being addressed. We felt like after going through spring leagues as players, we could provide valuable information to make the whole operation run a little bit smoother where, you know, there was things that weren't in place. And so that relationship over there has been very well. And like I said, when you take your focus off of the USFL and look at the XFL, it's like you have Hall of Famers, you have people who have really spent a lot of time at high levels. And it shows by the departments that they have in place and kind of the time they've taken to get this thing off the ground and the things that they've been able to do leading up to that. You don't get that sense of that it's rushed or that things are getting missed out or anything like that. So I think now, you know, players are very happy from an overall standpoint of opportunities that are on the table from a USFL standpoint, from XFL standpoint. I think players are at the table making things trying to get things as good as they can and make situations better in the USFL. And I think XFL, obviously they're not off the ground yet, but I think the groundwork that they've done for the past year, guys are really confident in. So I think the overall landscape of what football is and opportunities that are out there, guys are there's a lot more ease on guys' minds right now. I think now more than ever after going through 2 years where it was cut short, 1 year because of, you know, funny business situations and 1 year because of COVID. I think the landscape of spring football is kind of smoothing out really well right now.
Oh, I love how he said that, Arlington. Did you notice he referred to your favorite league, Charlie's League, as funny business and then XFL as
COVID. He's not going to say it. And I don't expect him to say it either. But you said it for him.
Right. See, Kenneth, you got to realize, Arlington, he's going to sit here and try to blow smoke up your butt. But his favorite league for all spring football was Charlie's League. He loved the AAF. Charlie Ebersole was the greatest thing in the world. So you see, look at him. See how upset he is because you made fun of Charlie's League?
I found very interesting...
Sir, I'm getting ready to ask the question to our guest here on the Afternoon Delight Show, which our special guest is Kenneth Farrell, the president of the United Football Players Association and the former running back for the Seattle Dragons, hopefully not the new running back for the San Antonio Yellow Bellies.
Would you hopefully stop saying that?
Did you see that? Did you see that, Mr. Farrell, that the San Antonio's new name is the Yellow Bellies?
No, you
Have
didn't.
Have you seen that?
No, I haven't seen that. That doesn't sound true. Look,
Thank you.
Does this face lie? Does this face lie?
Oh my God. We really going there today?
Here's what I found. Listen, Arlington. Here's what I really found in her talking about certain things. Where the USFL seemed rushed, right? Now, the fans with the XFL, Kenneth, now, like we've been having conversations. Fans of the XFL are just beyond themselves that we ain't hearing anything, nothing at all. Like, is that what the players are hearing? Are you guys hearing things, or is it just like you guys are being ghosted too? Like the majority of the fans think that they're being ghosted.
No, I don't think that's the case at all. I think there's been good information put out to guys that have participated in the showcases. There's been communication guys that are in the draft pool. So no, and I think, you know, as far as team names and things like that, with all the things that they've gotten set up, I'm pretty sure that, you know, that's the least of players' worries are team names and stuff like that. They have everything that they need to have set up. You know, I think by everything else that they've done to this point, I think they're going to have everything ready to go when it's time. So players aren't too worried about that right now. And the communication and things like that have been good. I think guys feel really good about what's going on.
Excellent. Hey, I love hearing that. As a matter of fact, sir. Hey, as a matter of fact, he was sitting there and he was telling us everything, you know, that's going on, you know, with the players and whatnot. And I have no problem with that whatsoever. As we're talking with Kenneth Farrow right now on the X Fan Show. One of the things that I wanted to touch on with you, Kenneth, is dang it. I hate when, because Dirty does this to me all the time. It makes me forget questions because he's sitting there making faces while we're doing this show. Yeah, you don't act silly now, like you know what I'm don't know what I'm talking about here. You sit there doing that.
We have a guest on. We have a guest on this show. Be professional.
I'm trying to be, and you're not making it better for me, dude. You're not. But
here, I got a question.
Go ahead. Go for it.
With all the coaching staff that you've seen, right? I want you to play, take yourself out of being a player, or, you know, or anything. I just, with the coaching staffs that you've seen for all 18, what do you think has the best coaching staff, or with two parts, the best coaching staff or the staff that you would like to be on as a player?
Man, I'll be honest, that's tough because, I mean, I feel like they really are loaded with football experience. You got Wade Phillips, you got Terrell Buckley, Rod Woodson, Hines Ward, I mean, Anthony Beck. All those guys have a ton of football experience and have done it at a high level. So, yeah, that's hard. I can't even pick one. I would say I grew up watching, you know, more of like Rod Woodson, Hines Ward, you know what I mean? Those type of guys. I think those would be, you know, cool to be a part of their team. But man, as a fan and as a player, I don't think it's very hard to pick one because all these guys are super credentialed and super, you know, they're kind of legends in the game. So yeah, I think from a fan standpoint, that's what you want. You want to see a whole bunch of guys that have got a lot of stripes on them, you know what I mean, that have done a lot of good things for the game.
And then as a player standpoint, which one?
Like I said, I think Hines Wood or Rod Woodson, just because I watch those guys the most out of the guys that are up there. So definitely one of those two.
Oh, man. See, Arlington's back. See, then if you do the Hines Ward, then you would be a yellow belly. And I don't know if I could root for you. Yellow belly. I just don't know if I could root for you being a San Antonio yellow belly.
Hey, okay, I got my question now. Now that I've got it. Okay, check this out. So,
turn yourself down. You're loud. You almost blew our eardrums out there.
Kenneth. Let me ask you this. There, of course, you talked about the showcases and things. Has there been like any feedback from the players that you heard about, like, you know, like potential scams and stuff, you know, because people are posting saying, hey, we got XFL showcases here, and it turned out it's a scam. Like, have you been hearing any feedback about that from different players that are trying to get into the XFL?
No, I think the showcases that the XFL have put on have all been legit. I think, you know, that's kind of something that we're trying to keep a finger and a pulse on is, you know, when these combines and when these invitations get sent out, which ones are legit, which ones are truly from the league, which ones are really have the connections that they say they have. So as far as the XFL showcases, we haven't heard any negative things about it. But I mean, I feel like we are constantly trying to find, you know, these so-called combines or showcases that have been put on where, you know, there is no true connection to what they say they're connected to, which has been an unfortunate event a couple of times, but trying to crack down on that as much as possible.
That's good news to hear. I love hearing that, man. Hey, we don't want to take up too much of your time. So before you go, Kenneth, if you could tell those that are watching with us today, you got one more question for him?
Those arms. Those arms are jacked. His arms. Yeah. Did you see those things? Look.
I do.
I mean, that's before a gun show. That's a gun.
Yeah. Exactly. Before you go, can you tell everyone where they can find you on social media if they want to reach out to you?
At Twitter, Kenneth M. Farrow. Twitter is probably the best one.
Okay.
Perfect. See, there you go. And if you guys want, if you're a spring football person, are you going to put us back up, Arlington? You're just going to leave it
on? Yes, I'm putting you back up, man. Don't worry about that.
You guys are definitely a spring football guy, player, or anything like that. Reach out to this man. This man did a lot of work. He has set up all a very good thing for you, you spring football players. Reach out to him. You know, the United Football Players Association is a great thing for spring football players. And as you heard, the man's been sitting there. He's been seeing it. He's saying spring now. Did you okay? So, Ken, my last question with the USFL announcing their second season, the XFL kicking in 2023, right?
Right.
Do you think football is here to stay, or do you think this is going to be the old 80s USFL or Charlie's League or the United League? I mean, or do you think it's really here to stay? Do you think it's going to have some survival?
No, I think one of our main goals as a players association was being able to get in and try to help to be able to make these things. The number one goal is sustainable. And I think with the USFL, them being able to complete their whole first season, the success that they had with Fox kind of backing it the way that they were able to come in and do that, and then us being able to get to the table and have a real relationship with them to try to make things better where we see fit. I think that's that is going to provide, help and the longevity of that league. And then you look ahead at the XFL, who's yet to have their first season, but you look at the partnerships that they have in place. I think after having 2-3 years of, you know, ups and downs and kind of trial and errors, I think we're finally at a place where everybody's kind of got it figured out from a business standpoint. You see the hub cities kind of being a thing to try to make sure that you can get off the ground the first couple of years, maybe, and you know how they start to expand those things out. But I think the models are kind of coming into form to figure out how it can be made to last. And I think we're finally there now, which is exciting because, like I said, you have two leagues, you got 800 more opportunities for guys to hit the field and hopefully continue to chase their dreams. And keep doing what they're doing.
Fantastic stuff. I love hearing
it. I do have one more than that. Now, with your union, it just dawned on me. I was talking about it. It's a good one. With your union that's being a setup for the Spring League, have you had any contact with the NFL's Player Association where they said, hey, love what you're doing for these alt guys? Let us help you. Let us give you some advice. Has the NFL Players Association reached out to the United Football Players Association to kind of share some stuff with you or anything like that, or work with you in any way?
Right. So, I mean, really, when it comes to the union standpoint, the UFPA was able to get the backing of the United Steelworkers. So we're kind of partnered with the Steelworkers to be able to do that. And we got there's been a new group with AFL-CIO that includes NFLPA, the United Steelworkers, and the United Football Players Association, a couple soccer league players unions, and a couple other unions. I'm sorry for not remembering the names, but there is a group that has kind of come together, and I think that will be something that we are able to do, meet with multiple organizations to kind of figure out, you know, how we best move forward with where we're at, kind of starting at an infancy level of a players union with a new league. So and I think that's just, that helps the players. The more we can all come together at every level and talk about, you know, the pros, the cons, the negatives and positives, and what worked and what didn't work, I think that benefits the players overall. So that's definitely something that's in the works.
Yeah, see, and there's a reason why I asked that question, Arlington, because if you're in a union, you leave a union, then you have tenureship with the union. That means you can kind of slide easily into another union without, like, different, like, a bunch of different mumbo-jumbo. And am I right, Kenneth? I mean, that's the way it would work. You're already tenured in one, and then you can move over. So that's really exciting to hear that you're getting kind of help, that these people are reaching out and saying, hey, let us help you. And, you know, and you said you kind of have the NFL Players Union saying, hey, you guys are just starting up. Here's what we need to do. So, I mean, dude, big kudos to you, because that's a very big deal when you got one of the bigger player unions that are, you know, saying that they're going to help you.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, and that's kind of been a group that was started by, like I said, the FIL-CIO. But, you know, I think one of our big supporters, too, in the beginning was the CFLPA. The CFLPA is also partnered with the steelworkers up in Canada. And so a lot of the guys have crossover from the CFLPA and some of these spring leagues. So CFLPA has been very supportive of us from the jump. And especially when we were going into election times and things like that. So, like I said, at the end of the day, you know, all of us players have played all over the place. And so there is no separation in what we need is benefits and things like that. So the more we can come together and communicate those things amongst each other, the better it helps everybody.
Fantastic. That is amazing stuff, man. Kenneth, hey, so much. Thank you so much for coming on board today and touching a bit about what's been going on with you. And of course, giving you a bit of memory back from the Seattle Dragon days as well. Oh, yeah. Man, you are always welcome to come on the X Fan Show. This is a show for the fans, and you're getting, gave some education on what's been going on with the Players Association. So thank you so much.
No problem, man. I appreciate y'all for having me on.
Hey, man, we got to meet up soon, okay, man? So we can break bread and whatnot, man.
We do.
All right, man. You take care, and best of luck to you.
All right, y'all.
No yellow.
I appreciate it.
No yellow belt.
That is Kenneth Farrow, ladies and gentlemen. Thankful for him to come on board, man. Yeah, man.
As a player, I mean, what people don't realize is what that man started, right? From the ground up, right?
Right.
That United Football Players Association. Unions are not an easy thing to start up, to get a bunch. What the heck is going on? God, I am ugly.
Yep, we're going to make sure you're ugly today.
Yeah, no, it's bad enough they got to look at me and I'm all chalky looking. You know, I don't have that nice, beautiful glove that you have. I have this chalky white glove. To start a union from the ground up is not an easy thing to do. And
it's then not.
To go into states where you might have a right to work type of state or a non-compete state. Or something like, I mean, there's a lot into it. And I mean, the hours that man put in, that, you know, Kenneth Farrow put into that to get that for the people of the USFL, and possibly, as you know, as their union got to look at the XFL stuff, like he said, saying, okay, as of right now, you know, it doesn't look too bad, but it sounds like they are going to give options to the players of the XFL to join their union if they want. I mean, kudos to them. And then to have the backing of the CFL and the steelworkers and all of those, and the NFL players, NFL Players Association reached out. That's a lot of work, and to get it less than a year. I mean, it really is a lot of work.
And especially going over from what happened with Charlie's League and then Vince's iteration, you know, and going into now with the Rock and Danny's XFL, you know, you got to make sure. And then, of course, he mentioned the USFL. You got to make sure that those that are not playing at the next level are getting taken care of as well. You know, and kudos to Kenneth to making sure, and the team, because I know it's not just him. There's a team of people that's doing this. Yeah. To the team over at the United Football Players Association, making sure the players are getting taken care of, and just amazing to hear that from him. And just wish but nothing but success for him, you know, this point forward, especially with those that want to continue to play professional football.
Yeah, I mean, look, like I said, being a union guy myself, it's very, very hard to get a union built from the ground up. And to do that, it was great. And here, I'm glad the fans that were listening actually got to hear when you asked him, Arlington, what is it that you're seeing from a player standpoint of the XFL? Are they being a little more forthcoming with you guys? And he kind of alluded, yeah, they are being a little more forthcoming with us. We do know a little bit more than the normal people.
So guess what that lets me know? Guess what this let me know right then and there with what Kenneth said?
That there's stuff in place? That there's stuff in place?
Exactly. And that what is not being presented to the public is not being shown. Of course, it's not going to be shown because it's private. Behind the scenes, mm-hmm. stuff is moving. Things are moving. They're just mm-hmm. not going to show it to you publicly right now because they want to make sure it's 100% perfect or 99% done. You know what I mean? They want to make mm-hmm. sure that the completed project is finished so that way it can present it in a global realm.
Correct.
So right now, fans need to understand this. Right now, players don't care about the team names and logos. Right?
Nope. He did care about it. He didn't want to be a yellow belly.
He did say no. He said he wanted to play in Texas.
He didn't want to. No, he said he didn't want to be a San Antonio yellow belly.
I wouldn't mind seeing him in a Houston uniform playing with Wayne Phillips.
Okay? I'd much rather see him in a Battle Hawk uniform.
You know what? That would be awesome as well too, because that means I got to make trips to St. Louis. Then you know, like seriously,
right? Yeah. That is true.
So, well, hey, Kenneth, you need an agent, brother? You need somebody to come represent you? You know, because I'm trying to go home. I'm trying to go back home to St. Louis. You know, but seriously, though.
You do know agents usually pay for their own.
I know they do, man. And you know what? I have to pay my way back. I'm trying. You know, I get 10% of that, right? That paycheck.
Your head.
Oh my goodness. Hey, shout out to my guy Robert L. Bailey Jr. He's watching today, you know, big Cowboy fan, and they got burned by the Eagles. But that's a whole nother story.
Wait, Pastor Bailey is a Cowboys fan?
Yep.
Oh man, I don't know now. I don't know about that's an old Deucey Deuce too. That's an old Emmitt Smith one.
That is a Deucey Deuce. You can tell, can't you?
Pastor Bailey kind of broke there knowing you're a Cowboys fan, bro.
Hey, but that's neither here nor there, man. That's neither here nor there.
Cowboys fan.
Hey, let it go, man. Let it go. But yeah, man, but everything that we heard from today from Kenneth was he's really transparent on what's really going on behind the scenes. Not too many people will do that, you know. And
right, yeah.
And grateful enough, you know, he's given viable information not only for just himself, but for players that want to participate, you know, in the future and what they're doing for the players that are currently there right now. You know, and that's an amazing thing. And I wish nothing but the best for those players. Those that are really those that want to get back and clean.
If you're a player trying to look to get into the spring league or something like that, reach out to them.
Also, if you're looking for an agent, check out Pro Level Agents. I'm putting that out there because, of course, my guy Josh, you know, that passed away last year.
Look. You're wearing that Cowboys jersey, and it's making
what?
You start to
Oh, you talking about that? Really? Seriously? Is that what you're doing? Yeah. Is that what you're doing?
Cowboys jersey kind of made you drop your IQ a little.
You can't be serious right now, man.
Yeah, I am. I think.
But you remember our guy Josh Davis that you know participated with us on the XFL STL show and stuff like that. Well, you know, he helped spearhead players to getting over the plan with pro level agents. So if you're looking for an agent, make sure you go and check them out. You can go online and I think it's Pro Level Agents on Twitter and Pro Level Agents com. So
yes,
definitely. So you ready to get out of here?
Actually, you know what? I do. You know, listen. We broadcasted the other day, right?
Yeah.
And we forgot to say happy birthday to somebody.
Somebody close to you?
I mean, it was, you know, a former colleague of ours. Got a guy working on, you know, doing his own thing. Mr. Yes. Josh Price.
Will Freeman.
Will Freeman, you know, from that a football show. It was his birthday, so happy birthday, Will.
Happy birthday,
and
man.
And another guy that's close to us, you know, there's that dude that might have this little bit of a somewhat decent tailgate page here in St. Louis.
How? I got Rick?
I mean, it might be a little bit. It might be a little bit big.
A little bit.
Okay. Rick Story, it's his birthday today. Happy birthday, Rick. Enjoy your day. Go tailgate for some. Just go tailgate for your birthday, Rick.
You know you will, probably, more than likely, man. But hey, folks, hey, right. Thanks for those.
We reached out to you. Thank you for joining us today. We appreciate it.
Yes, indeed, man. Had a good conversation with Kenneth Farrow. And looking forward to more great conversation coming next week. Hopefully some stuff, if it does come out, we'll be here for you. And I mean, I want to make sure we talk about the game itself, because that's something that I like.
Next Tuesday, talk about the game.
Yeah, talk about the actual game itself. You know, that.
Maybe.
Sandy told us about, I made it.
Finally made it, yeah. So maybe some other coaches might let some stuff slip.
You think so? You think they might slip?
Maybe.
All right. Hey, as much as I want to see that happening, man, you know, if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, I'm not mad about it. You know what I'm saying? Like, real talk. All right, so that'll wrap things up. Chili. Say that again.
I got to go get stuff for chili.
Hey, I've already got some, so that's going to be my lunch for today. So, hey, folks, thank you so much for tuning in to this edition of the Afternoon Delight. Big thanks to our special guest, Kenneth Farrell, for joining us on the show from former Seattle Dragons and United Football Players Association. All right. And on that note, Dirty's going to go make some chili. I'm going to go eat some chili, and we are out.
I'm going to go buy the stuff for chili, but I'm going to finish my hot water.
So long, y'all. We out of here.